Good morning, everyone. We'll tell you all about what's going on in just a moment, but before we actually get underway, I wanted to take a second and light the candle, this candle, on the altar in honor of World AIDS Day this Friday. I've said to a few people lately, the last pandemic isn't over. I still lose a friend or two every year. It's much more manageable. Things are much, much better than they were 30, almost 40 years ago. But they're still difficult, and there's still a lot going on. And in memory and in reminder of World AIDS Day, because like another pandemic, it's still not over.
Good morning. Welcome to Mountain Vista Unitarian Universalist. This is my first time doing anything like this, and I am terrified. Thankfully, I have a paper here with some words to read, so things should go smoothly. I want to give a warm welcome to everyone here in person, on Zoom, and even in the future from the University of YouTube. If you're on Zoom, now is the time to turn those cams on, because we're all going to turn around, look at the camera, and wave back to you. Come on, let's see those cameras. All right. My name is Alex Stuckey, and I'll be the pastoral associate today. As mentioned, this is my first go being up here, so if it's remotely entertaining, then I'll give that a gold star. I'm working with one of our world-famous music director, Chris Tackett, the awesome and handsome Chris Tackett. Our minister, Reverend Matthew Funk Crary, is currently away this week. In the meantime, you're stuck with us. This service would not be possible without the magicians doing all the magical things in the background. We have Lee and Suzanne running the switching and Zoom. We have Chuck running the camera, and Todd making sure there's no loud screechy noises both in the sanctuary and on Zoom. We also have our religious exploration team being run by Stacy Sosa, making sure all the youngins don't get too bored and the parents can have just a moment of peace and quiet during this hour. I also want to thank our welcoming team. They're pretty much the reason I've kept coming back since first meeting you all here. And please also do not forget to thank our hospitality team who are getting all the snackies ready. Nothing like coffee and a sugary snack or six to end an hour of gratitude. Now, I have a question for all of you. Raise your hand if you know someone who does not like music. Weird, no one. Not many people, if any, and if so, we don't really talk about them, do we? It's hard to not like music with so much variety out there. It's hard to find something that doesn't move you in some way. Today, we are grateful for music and the joys it brings all of us. I've always loved music. For a while, though, I was mostly just listening to it. I've always had music in my head. I wanted to get out there via some medium, but I didn't think I had the skill set to do so. Fifth grade in elementary school was my first experience of that. I started playing the clarinet in the school band, being the person I am, though, and still am today. It was after elementary school that I realized there's all these cool instruments that exist out there. From sixth to seventh grade, I switched from cornet, tuba, and still my mind could not stop fantasizing about all the instruments I could play. Finally, in eighth grade, I went to my roots and picked up the bass clarinet for that year. However, even after eighth grade, I was still thinking about trying new instruments, like the bassoon, oboe. As you can guess, my parents have had enough of this, and as have I. So I finished my years of school not really thinking about music at all. Throughout my adult life, I've tried the ukulele, banjo, synthesizer, and even an arhu, which is the Chinese two-string violin that's really loud. I finally decided that wind instruments were my jam, so I recently purchased a cheap clarinet and have been playing over the past year. This has been one of the biggest joys of my adult life, is getting back into making music. Don't get me wrong, that tendency to try them all is still there. I currently have a clarinet, bass clarinet, alto sax, melodica, both treble and bass, penny whistle, ocarina, soprano, and tenor recorder, and literally yesterday I bought an oboe. It was really cheap, you guys. So don't be surprised if you see me up here with an oboe in the future. I still keep my main focus on my clarinet playing, but clearly I will not get bored of playing music. The next hour, myself and Chris will continue to share with you what it means to be grateful for the existence of music. All right, this is a... Oop. This is a quick poem called Music to Me by Ale Miller. Music to me can be loud, like thunder in my head. Music to me can be soft, that draws me to my bed. Music to me is life. Music to me is strong. Music to me makes me feel like I can do no wrong. Music makes you full of sorrow, or it makes you full of joy. Music makes a better tomorrow, or makes you awfully coy. Music makes you fearless. Music makes you tearless. Music can make you a star. Music to me is when you see who you really are.
As Alex said a moment ago, Reverend Matthew is away today, so you have us. And he also, as he said, this is his very first time doing anything like this. And I think he's doing an excellent job. Because I'm still standing here in front of you, and this is not my first time doing this. And I'm still going, oh, holy imposter syndrome, Batman. Anyway, this is a weird Sunday after Thanksgiving this year. It's not yet Advent. Because of the confluence of Thanksgiving being a little early and Christmas Eve is on a Sunday this year, the first Sunday after Thanksgiving is usually the first Sunday of Advent, and that's not the case this year. So we have one of these weird kind of in-between Sundays. I'm grateful, I'm thankful, I'm still feeling thankful, but I'm not quite ready to dive headlong into the December Christmas season yet. So I'm going to talk a little bit about gratitude and tell you about some of the people and some of the music and some of the things that have been an influence in my life. It's a little more personal than I usually get, but there's still going to be a lot of music woven in amongst all of it. We'll also take a moment later in the service when you can ask me any questions. I'm going to have the brave stance of opening up and taking questions. If you have any questions about music at MVUU, music in the UU Church, or even something about my life, although I reserve the right to refuse to answer anything too terribly personal, be thinking of questions for later. We're going to open with a standard hymn dressed up in new rhythmic garb, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. It's 126 in the gray hymnal, if you have one handy. Reverend Bethany at the UU Church of Tucson introduced this new rhythmic wrinkle to me, and I think it gives a really nice dancey feel to it. I've loved this song for years, but this rhythmic variation gives a lovely little dancey twist. Joel and Grace are in Seattle as well, so it's just us. Rise as you feel desire to, and let's sing together. Just come to choir on Wednesday nights. When I was a child, the annual broadcast of the 1939 MGM film Over the Rainbow, The Wizard of Oz, was an event absolutely not to be missed. Remember, this was a time before home videotape, no DVDs, no streaming services, no nothing. So the only chance you had to see something like that outside of a movie theater was when it was broadcast on network television. So it was a big deal when that came around every year. As a kid, I recall it being a giant piece of Technicolor candy. The novelty of the film opening in dreary black and white Kansas, and then a giant tornado whooshes up and blows Dorothy into Technicolor. Talk about tornadoes. The younger I was, the more I was mesmerized by the bright, colorful bits in the middle on the brand new color television my parents had gotten. The witch and the flying monkeys were a little intense and a little scary, not gonna lie, but very compelling even still. Of course, just when all looks lost, spoiler alert, the good wins out over the evil, the witch is defeated, the friends are reunited, and Dorothy gets back to her home in black and white Kansas. The world is restored to its proper order. Later, as a young teenager, and I came to realize that I was not like the other boys in so many ways, I began to identify more with Dorothy's intense longing to be anywhere other than where she was. Now, southwestern Pennsylvania in the 70s was not Dust Bowl black and white Kansas in the 30s. But I still felt that desire to live in full, bright technicolor. And I wasn't the only one. From the time that film was first released in 1939, gay men everywhere identified with Dorothy and her desire to be anywhere else than where she was. It's funny, that desire to be, the desire among young gay men to be somewhere else gave rise to the phrase, friends of Dorothy. It's quaint to us now, but that was a way of saying to somebody, oh, you know so-and-so, he's a friend of Dorothy. At a time when you wouldn't dare say to anyone for fear of being overheard, you would never say so-and-so was gay. Because if anybody overheard you, that would be the loss of your job, the loss of your family in many cases, and the loss of your social connections almost completely. So, friends of Dorothy it was. It also got funny because military police at one point discovered that phrase. And in an earlier era, just like Antifa, somebody found the phrase friends of Dorothy, and just like Antifa, they assumed it was some scary, well-organized cabal conspiracy working to destroy the American way of life. Oh, honey, no. So a big part of that longing is created early on through a song by Harold Arlen and Yip Harburg. Not to discount the wonderful lyrics, it's really the tune that creates that aching desire. The melody makes a big leap up, turns around a little bit, and then goes back to the beginning and makes another leap up, but not quite as high. It twists around a little bit more and makes another leap from a lower point, and then turns around and settles back down at where it began. That melody repeats, and you still wind up at the lower part of the phrase. But then there's a lovely bridge that gives you encouragement and gives you strength, and then you try again, and at the very end, why, oh, why can't I, you achieve that high point, that high location, that place they've been leaping for the entire time. Harold Arlen, born Hyman Arluck, was the son of a cantor and the grandson and great-grandson and great-great-great-grandson and so forth and so on of rabbis and cantors back into the dark ages in the mists of history. He really lived the plot of the jazz singer, except he didn't get the, you know, the big redemption in Yom Kippur in the last reel. Expected to follow in the footsteps of his ancestors and take his proper place on the bima in the synagogue, he instead started playing piano and singing in these newfangled jazz bands in the 1920s in Western New York State, where he grew up. He attracted a lot of attention as a singer and piano player, and it wasn't long before he started writing his own tunes. His jazz experience and his connections in that world led him ultimately to the Cotton Club in New York City, where he wrote songs and material for the famous Cotton Club Review. The Cotton Club Review and the radio broadcasts and film recordings and so forth was a launching ground for a lot of incredible African-American talent, including people like Cab Calloway, Duke Ellington, and the woman who made another one of Harold Arlen's songs a hit, Ethel Waters. She first sang Stormy Weather. It also launched the career of the not-black Harold Arlen. Soon Hollywood beckoned, and in the late 1930s, he and lyricist collaborator Yip Harburg were soon working on the songs for one of MGM's big musicals of that year, and the rest, as they say, is history. In the fall of 1997, I got to work on a big Harold Arlen review at the U of A, and I got to really study and dig into Arlen's music for the first time. It's been a big influence on me ever since. The verse of this song is a nearly perfect setup for the main chorus, and it's kind of a shame because hardly anyone ever does the verse anymore. They all want to get to the famous meaty bit. I've asked our own Robin to come and sing it with me.
when all the world is a hopeless jumble and the raindrops tumble all around. When all the clouds darken up the skyway, there's a rainbow highway to be found, leading from your window pane to a place behind the sun. A step beyond the rain, somewhere over the rainbow, way up high, there's I've heard of once in a lullaby. Somewhere over the rainbow, skies are blue. A star and wake up where the clouds are far behind me, where troubles melt like lemon drops away above the chimney tops. That's where you
script back. So, here we are on the edge of the holiday season again. Like I said, Advent doesn't start this week. Advent is the four Sundays that lead up to Christmas in the formal Christian high church calendar. And technically, it's a penitential season, like Lent, if you're familiar. It's a chance to pause and reflect on your life and your works before the great celebration of Christmas begins on Christmas Day. Then the 12 days of Christmas begin, culminating in Epiphany when the wise men show up. Yes, Christmas Day is only the first day of Christmas, so don't start with the partridges and pear trees until December 25th. You and your true love have plenty of time still. There are Advent hymns and carols and readings for the season, but most of the things we consider Christmas songs are really only supposed to appear on Christmas Day and in the 2 weeks that follow. Western capitalism and the American way of Christmas and the commercialization of the season, yes, Charlie Brown, that is a thing, has modified the calendar somewhat, or rather blown it completely out of the water. Modern American Christmas now starts the day after Thanksgiving, if not earlier, like right after Halloween in some places, and ends abruptly at midnight, December 25th. I recall being in a Target on like midday on December 26th one day, and it was like Christmas had never happened. Everything was scrubbed off the walls, scrubbed off the shelves. All the decorations were gone, and we went on with the rest of our lives. So if we don't take the penitential season, if we don't take the chance of Advent, we don't really get the chance to take time to reflect on the changing of the seasons, the mood of the world at this point, and I think that's kind of a shame. In years past, when I was doing a lot more Christmas professionally, singing in caroling groups, playing at parties, working in three or four different churches, I would often get completely burnt out and tired of Christmas by Christmas Eve. So I read up on Advent traditions and tried some of them, and it helped. So I didn't do a whole lot of decorating at home until just before Christmas Day. And I tried to spend a little time each day calming and centering myself so I could relax and be present for the season. And then I could celebrate in the 2 weeks after Christmas Day, when my calendar all of a sudden got really light. I've even thrown Christmas and holiday parties after Christmas Day. My friends think it's weird, but my friends already think it's weird, and more of them were free and available to come. So it worked out. The first church service I ever played as a pianist and organist was when I was 16 in the church I grew up in, Grace United Methodist Church in Indiana, Pennsylvania. Kenneth W. Nordby was the organist. He was a single, older gentleman, and was old enough to have been around for the end of the silent movie era and the theater organs that were a part of that. Now, theater organ playing is a different style of playing. It's a different thing from playing in churches. In theater, playing for movies, playing for silent movies, it almost doesn't matter what you play, as long as it kind of matches the action on the screen, and at least somewhat in the neighborhood, and it does not stop. Other than that, you can play almost anything. And the pressure to keep the music going resulted in some rather serious musical shenanigans. Mr. Nordby brought that sensibility to playing for church services and also to his work as the civic community organist, playing for high school graduations and other events. Now there's a job that doesn't really exist anymore either. He was one of the best at hiding subversive tunes in lovely textures, something I've taken great pleasure in doing during my church career. For example, he'd play something like this. Just lovely, until you realize that it's So he would do this as social commentary when certain ministers processed, or specific town elders rose to speak, or when certain younger friends crossed the stage to collect their diplomas. If you were clued into what he was doing, you knew exactly what he was thinking. If anyone ever called him out for it, he'd just go, "Oh, well, that was the classical piece that tune was based on," and walk away, leaving them scratching their heads. That sense of humor and low-level subversiveness have served me well and helped me survive a lot of work in a lot of terrible places. One of the very few sad things for me about working here is that I don't have to hide the profane tunes anymore. I can play them right out in the open, and y'all are good with it, and I love that. Thank you. Let's sing an Advent song, number 224 in the gray hymnal, "Let Christmas Come." It's UU words sung to a folk tune set by Ralph Vaughan Williams, an English organist and later well-known composer in the first half of the 20th century, and another big influence on me as a young musician. We'll go into that another time. Let's stand and sing 224, "Let Christmas Come." I moved to Tucson in 1997. In 1999, I was working as the pianist and organist at Saguaro Christian Church, a Disciples of Christ church out on the east side of town near Broadway and Sarnoff. Keith Koster was the music director at that time, and as a friend, he wanted to encourage me as a composer. So he asked me if I'd like to write the big Christmas cantata for the big Christmas music Sunday that year. In the spirit of say yes and work out the details later, I said yes. And I said that I've always had a great kinship with shape note hymns. So I proposed a Christmas cantata based on the shape note tradition. This is a facsimile edition of the Southern Harmony. And shape note singing, if you're not familiar, is a rough, unaccompanied style of singing where in the traditional presentation, I have a slide to show you, the notes are standard on standard music staves with standard rhythmic notation, but I don't know if you can see it, the notes are differently shaped note heads for each of the different pitches. This was a method for teaching people who were barely literate with words to teach them music. A singing teacher would gather in church and teach people how to sing with these books. The tunes are mostly limited in range and scale pattern and have a very primitive, to our ears at least, harmonic language. They don't follow the standard classical rules of harmony and melody, and they were music for the people, by gum. This tradition, though, has created some of the most memorable tunes in the American canon and are still around today, although many of them are dressed up in more genteel, traditional harmonic clothing. Our own Singing the Living Tradition, aka the Gray Hymnal, from 1993 has at least 25 songs, hymns and songs, set to tunes derived from the Sacred Harp and the Southern Harmony, the two most popular original books. In fact, the opening hymn we sang this morning, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, is from that tradition, although in the original setting, you'd be hard-pressed to recognize it as cleanly and as clearly. In fact, also, the tune that is actually called New Britain, but we know better for the words most commonly associated with it, Amazing Grace, is from the Virginia Harmony in 1831. So here I am, young me, wanting to write a big Christmas piece with source material that comes from a rural, primitive evangelical tradition that doesn't really celebrate Christmas. In fact, in some places, Christmas was banned. So in all the books and resources I could find in 1999, remember, Google barely existed and was still actively trying not to be evil at that point, there were like four songs with actual Christmas texts that I could find, and two or three others that could be considered somewhat appropriate. I'm going to have the choir come and sing the one piece that came to be the centerpiece for this cantata, Star in the East. This is mostly unmodified from the original shape note sources. Choir, that's your cue. Now, the melody is in the tenor, so listen for that. The tenors are standing over here. Will be in a moment. And the harmony does not follow classical rules, and the vocal production is not subtle or gentle in any way. Now, we're not going to go to the full leather-lunged style of vocal production that was traditional with these pieces, but we're still trying to emulate a bit of that sound. Don't forget, these people were singing for God, not for each other, and most definitely not for an audience. So they wanted to be sure that God would hear them. You can turn me off. Applause in church. That's a whole other topic we'll get to at some point, I'm sure. But yeah, wasn't that great? Exciting, energetic. It's a tune that obviously does not follow any of the classical rules. It ain't Bach. So I took this text and tune and reset it in a more modern fashion. I really wanted to keep some of that primitive flavor. Now, I keep saying primitive, and I don't mean that as any kind of value judgment, and I don't mean that in any way other than it's rough-hewn music sung by, let's be honest, rough-hewn people. I love the rustic feel of it, and it is uniquely American. And many other American composers have also mined this tradition for material. Aaron Copland especially used many tunes in this style, especially in his so-called populist era. When I hear this piece that I wrote some 20 years ago, I definitely hear a young composer who's listened to Appalachian Spring maybe one too many times. And you'll hear exactly what I'm talking about in just a moment. Over the course of this about 20-minute work, you travel from sunset on that first Christmas Eve through the birth of the baby, the arrival of the shepherds, and then with a bit of foreshadowing, the wise men show up. The piece ends with sunrise, which is basically the same music as the sunset, only in reverse. And I have a score video for you of this first movement. I made this score video recently because I'm trying to drum up another performance or two of it. Ask any composer. First performances are easy. Everybody wants to do a world premiere. Getting a second performance or a third performance, that's much trickier. The opening chords in the instrumental tune are the last rays of the sun falling from the sky. And then once it's dark, the tempo picks up and the choir enters. You don't need to try and follow the score. If you don't read music or if you don't follow music easily, that's okay. Just close your eyes and listen. This is the opening movement of my first Christmas cantata. I've written two more. Brightest and Best from 1999. Three-part mixed choir, woodwind quintet, and piano. Keith Koster conducts the sanctuary choir of Saguaro Christian Church, and I'm the piano player, so.
Thank you.
sweet listening to old recordings because you hear them in different places and different spaces, and the EQ of things comes off different. And I recognize the voices of at least three people in that choir. They're now gone. It's 24 years ago. Good Lord. So, at risk, at my own personal peril, does anybody have any questions? Yes. Let me hand you the microphone, because otherwise the people online can't hear you.
Please help me understand the role of hip-hop. NPR had a whole series recently. Mm-hmm. I'm sure all of us have one or another time listened mm-hmm. to NPR, about the commemoration of the 50th anniversary of hip-hop.
Okay.
Is hip-hop the Black Panthers of music? Or what is hip-hop, and why should I appreciate? I can say, well, they are doing their thing, but that doesn't help me appreciate what their thing is. And I find it very hard to listen to the violence, sexism, and other things that hip-hop has. So lead me out of that tunnel, oh guru.
Degree in jazz studies, and I have interacted a lot with music from all over the place. And let me preface this by saying, yes, you're exactly right. Not all music is for everyone. Yes, there are certain strains of hip hop, there are certain strains of performance, there are certain strains of that music that do glorify violence, that do have sexist, misogynistic, extremely homophobic, and very ugly content in it. Fortunately, though, that's a relatively small percentage of it. And that's the one that, of course, gets the press, like a lot of things. Hip-hop is a natural evolution that comes right down out of, you have blues, you have jazz, klezmer's a thread off of that same tree. You get down into swing, you get down into bebop, and then the world splinters. You have the folk music that contributes to that. You have Broadway and theater music that is part of that thread. And all of these various things are part of the rich history. Hip hop now comes out of that, out of a combination of rhythm and blues, came to prominence in the late 40s to the 50s, and a little bit of rock and roll, and a little bit of dance music. There's a lot of hip hop music that comes straight out of dance culture in the 60s and 70s, which was very intensely African American, was also very intensely gay at the time. So it always strikes me funny when I hear some homophobic lyric over top of a beat that was created by a DJ who was a gigantic queen. So that always is. That all said, I'm not the person to spend a whole lot of time talking about this because I don't spend a whole lot of time studying or listening to a lot of hip hop. I appreciate its influence in a lot of places nowadays. In a lot of ways, a lot of the things that Lin-Manuel Miranda are doing are very heavily influenced by hip hop. Hamilton in particular has a lot of the earmarks of hip hop, including samples, DJ work in it, and the style of singing and the style of rap. Now there's the whole thing, the world of rap and spoken word poetry, that comes straight out of the 40s, 50s, 60s beatnik poetry, rhythmic poetry, and it all merges to create hip hop. In some ways though, punk is in there as well too. Yeah, I'm not the person to try and explain it all to you, but it's part of a rich tapestry of a much bigger thing. Nothing in this world exists on its own. And I don't know that I have a particularly better answer to give to you than that. But once again, not everything has to be for everybody. I don't listen to a lot of it myself, even though I recognize where a lot of the threads that are in it come from. And I'm also fascinated to watch, because you get to certain things and then you get to Hamilton. So how does Hamilton fit into that whole continuum of everything? I have no idea.
I looked up on Reddit or I looked up on the Google nonviolent rappers, and it says Gambino, Rage Against the Machine. And so if you're interested in delving into it, there's a Google search for that too.
There are Google searches for a lot of things. Yes. Ray.
Good job giving him a tough one, you guys.
Yeah, you want to give him the microphone? Oh. So the people at home and the people using the hearing assist can hear you.
Here's a somewhat facetious question. You regularly invite all of us to show up for choir practice on a Wednesday evening. My question is, if you showed up for choir practice on a Wednesday evening and every member of the congregation had shown up for choir practice, what would you do?
We would sing our ever-loving hearts out. We would stand here, we would sit here, we would pass out the hymnals. I normally come to choir with about 30 copies of something. And most of the time, we have enough copies for everybody. If we wound up in a time where we didn't have enough copies for everybody, you know what? We'll share, we'll pull the hymnals off the shelf over there, we will do all these things, we will learn. Give me that problem. Oh, I would love to have that problem. We will stand, like I said, we will stand and we will sing our ever-loving hearts out. That's exactly what we would do.
So back in the day when I was involved in church music, and it was inspired by the Christian mm-hmm. tradition, Catholic in specific, when I would sing, I would feel the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, I don't feel that anymore because I jettisoned the whole thing, which is why I'm here. As you compose mm-hmm. and as you play, where does your inspiration come from, and what are you thinking?
Once again, thanks for the easy questions. As I work and as I write and as I play, I should preface this by saying I grew up in a Christian tradition. I grew up in a Methodist church. I came to love choir and organ. And I loved all the stuff in the music. And yes, I felt that indwelling, that welling of spirit. It took me a while to realize that what I was feeling was not a Christian God. It was not a special Holy Spirit. It was humanity, for lack of a better word. It was the combination of the spirits of all of us. It was a combination of the energy of all of us. I don't consider myself a Christian. I don't consider myself Jewish, although a lot of my mental ethics and brain and everything comes from the Jewish tradition, once again, for having worked for them for the last two decades. And even though I worked for Christian churches for the bulk of my career, I don't consider myself, my religion is art. I go to concerts. I go to museums. I go to performances. I go to plays. I watch things on TV. As much as I love live performance, I have been celebrating so much is now available on streaming. I have gone around the world many times hearing and seeing concerts, performances, lectures. Just recently I was watching a lecture about the restoration of the stained glass windows in Coventry Cathedral in Great Britain. Gorgeous, gorgeous stuff. And I realized a number of years ago, my religion is art. My specific spiritual practice is music. And the spirit, the welling up that I get from that is equal to, or frankly, I feel like it's greater. Maybe I'm just developing and getting older, who knows, too. But I feel like my religion, my spiritual practice, my religious practice is art and music. And that's where it comes from for me. And I feel like, far from being poorer for having let go of that earlier conception for God, I feel like my life is that much richer. Back to the hip-hop question, I can see and hear people's hearts at work in some of that music. Not all of it, once again, it's not intended for me, but I can recognize the art and the heart and the humanity in it. And as such, I love it all. I love all art and music. Not all of it's for me, but that's okay. That's perfectly okay. I think one more question. Robin, what's up?
If you had the resources, what would it be that you would dream about bringing musically to MVUU?
Oh my.
Let's get a checklist going.
Don't cancel me. I mean, don't. I have giant grandiose dreams that simply won't fit in this room, so don't even bother. I would love to have an orchestra. I would love to have a gigantic choir, but once again, won't fit in this room, so that's okay. I would like to see more people participate. I would love to have more people involved. That takes no more resources. Okay, I have to get some more music. That's okay, we'll get more music. If we have that problem, we'll get more music. I would like to find a way to reintegrate organ in the service here. Now, I know a lot of us, myself included, come from a tradition where organ was the voice of the church. And because organ was the voice of the church, unfortunately and unfairly, the organ carries all of the unfortunate baggage and bullshit that we come to this church to get away from. But when you look at it from a personal musical standpoint, the organ is nothing more than an orchestra that one person gets to play. The organ has strings, the organ has woodwinds, the organ has brass, the organ has sounds and percussion, some have percussion in them, all of these wonderful things. And when I've been in a place that has an organ that has the appropriate sounds in it, it's lovely to play with folk groups and a little bit of organ to buoy it up. It's like having strings come in. When you play with rock groups and the organ can keep, I've been listening a lot to Anna Lapwood, who's a British organist who plays primarily at the Royal Albert Hall, which is an enormous hall in London that has one of the most enormous, fully operational pipe organs in the world. Amazing monster of a beast. She's taken to playing rock and roll shows where these rock and roll stuff is coming up and where the organ sits kind of high up above the stage. Then the organ comes in and just, it's amazing. And I would love to bring something like that here. I've been loosely keeping my eye open because a lot of places are getting away from organ. There are a lot of instruments. We simply don't have room to put pipes in here unless I can have the whole upstairs? We could take the whole upstairs and put pipe chambers. It would be really nice. But there's a lot of lovely electronic instruments that are going for pretty darn cheap. And I just need a little bit of budget and possibly some sweat equity, and we could do that. And I would absolutely love to see, because in the spirit that we are reclaiming words that are problematic for some of us, I have a real hard time with a W word, worship. What are we worshiping? Don't answer that question. That's not right for that discussion. But we have, and even the saying, some of those other words, I would like to do the same to see organ music restored to a prominent place in our church and frankly in culture. And it's just not happening so far, but. There's all kinds of wonderful Hammond and electronic instruments. I'd probably want something more classically oriented, but it would be lovely. The fun of having electronic instruments is you can put those sounds in them. So there's all kinds of fun stuff we can do. Okay, one more hymn and one more brief story. I'm sorry, catch me afterwards. I'd love to talk to you. And if any of you have questions, I do have other things I've been doing and other channels I've been trying to get out. If you have other questions, just send them to me. You can find me at chris.tackett@mvuu.org, And you can always catch me. I'm always all up here after services, so come up and say hi. We're going to close with what's become one of my favorite hymns. It's just nothing but a rollicking, fun barn burner of a song that also carries some really intense messaging. I forget the number, 149? 149, lift every voice and sing. I would love, love, love to tear into the theological meaning, to tear into all of it, and go into especially the kind of bloody and ugly second verse, which we're not singing today. So let's stand and sing. First and third verses, lift every voice and sing. Is exactly what I would do if y'all showed up on a Wednesday night. All right? We have a couple of quick announcements before I let you go tonight. This month, our woven basket offering has been for the Emerge Center Against Domestic Abuse. All of that is out in the Oasis. Coming up very soon, the Blue Prairie Dogs, Dan Ovid's band, and our own Roy and Charlie as well, will be appearing live in person right here at MVUU on Friday evening, December 8th at 7 p.m. I need you to promise me I have another job on Friday nights and I can't come, so I need y'all to come, okay? Would you do that for me? Dan founded the Blue Prairie Dogs more than 25 years ago to reflect the culture and the land and the wonderful beauty and music of the Southwest in a really entertaining way. They've been seen at the Tucson Folk Festival and all around Tucson and Southern Arizona. Don't miss them. Again, Friday evening, December 8th at 7 p.m. There'll be a requested donation and refreshments will be served. Next slide, please. Coming up on December 18th from 6 to 8 p.m. in this space, we're trying a new kind of event called Winter Chill. Y'all familiar with the Polar Express? That giant train that carries you all the way right up to Christmas. Did you ever wish it had a quiet car? The quiet car, that lovely concept from the MTA and from the, I think New York City and a number of different places have it, where commuting train, where it's quiet. No talking, no noise. You can sit and read or think or do whatever. And so this is the quiet car on the Polar Express this year. Escape from the holiday chaos with us at Winter Chill on Monday evening, December 18th from 6 to 8 p.m. This is a new kind of event. It's not a concert, but a quiet space to read, meditate, indulge in a quiet craft, or even bring and finish up your last few Christmas cards. Winter Chill is an opportunity to spend quiet time together enjoying the vibe inside in the sanctuary and out in the oasis. And if you'd rather have a quiet, soft conversation, we'll have the fire pit lit, we'll have light refreshments, and I'll be here playing some light piano to help set the mood. Offering baskets will be available and proceeds will go to the music fund. Did someone just say organ fund? Don't know about that. We'll see. We'll see. We'll talk. I haven't even begun to think about that. For words of chalice releasing today, I have found, or Alex found it for me, which once again, thank Alex for his amazing help today. The incredible Frank Zappa, another big influence on me, believe it or not, in many, many different ways, famously wrote, "Information is not knowledge. Knowledge is not wisdom. Wisdom is not truth. Truth is not beauty. Beauty is not love. Love is not music. Music is the best." I was a terrible piano student. When I was in third grade, around the age of 8, Mom said, "You're going to take piano lessons." I said no. Mom said yes. She won. She was Mom, after all. She took me to a good friend of hers, Abby Morris. And I took to it right away, but I still wasn't a good student. Mrs. Morris tried her best, but I didn't want to practice. I didn't like the simplistic music in the lesson books. I threw my books in every lesson. After about a year, Mrs. Morris went back to my mother and said, "I'm sorry, I can't take this anymore." By that time, fourth grade, I discovered band. I had wanted to play the horn, the French horn, in the middle of the orchestra, but they took one look at me and said, "Nope, tuba for you, large child." I said, "No, absolutely not." And we compromised on the trombone. I mean, who ever heard of tuba solos? I grew up being best friends to a guy who is now the principal tubist in the New York Philharmonic. So go figure. Anyway, so I got really curious. Why is it that when I played one thing on trombone, and Ben, one of my best friends and the lucky duck who got the horn, played something else, and then Laurie played something on trumpet that was different still, why did it sound good together? I started swiping scores out of the conductor's book, and I took them to the piano, and I tried to figure them out. My meager piano skills weren't much help. About this time, I found a record on a shelf in the music room. There it is. I took it home, put it on my record player, and it blew my young mind wide open. The leadoff track on side one was take 5, and the big featured track near the end of side 2 was Blue Rondo a la Turk. I had to play the piano. I don't know what magic my mother worked with Mrs. Morris, or what kind of promises she had to make, but Mrs. Morris took me back and proceeded to fill my head with all the great American songbook stuff that she'd known and loved as a young pianist working and rehearsing in the stage shows in the post-war boom in the enormous resorts in the Catskills. I never forgot that Dave Brubeck record, though, or the other record that those two pieces came from, Time Out. I suppose I could return that record one of these days. In high school, I discovered that the music for those pieces had been published, and I had to learn how to play them. So I got the scores and set to work. In graduate school, I got to meet Mr. Brubeck. He was at a jazz festival, and my college band was also playing. We were there for 2 weeks, and like a lot of commercial, professional work like that, you perform, and it's great, and for the other 22 hours of the day, there's not a lot to do. So I was gratified to learn that he was a very kind and gracious man, and we spent several hours hanging out together during the 2 weeks of that festival. His wife, Iola, and his son, Chris, who was playing bass in his band at that time, were with him on the trip, and they were all very kind and indulgent to an unbelievably starstruck young man. I even went on to do some copy work, some notation work for Mr. Brubeck, shaping up his attempts at notation into something that more classically trained musicians could play more easily. Like a lot of jazz musicians, he didn't have a whole lot of formal classical training. He did have some. He studied with some of the great composers of the 20th century, but he never learned the full how to write music, how the notation system really works. So he'd send me a tape of him playing and explaining pieces to me, along with his penciled attempts at trying to figure out what was in his head. I'd listen, and I'd try to figure out what he actually meant to say. And he had several people who did that throughout his career, including his own brother, Howard. But I never forgot those original pieces. I swear, some of that music has worked its way into my DNA by now. I don't play them very often anymore, but they're never terribly far from my fingers. And yes, I need the page-turning pedal for this because